My dear friends, it is a joy to speak to you again. The topic I've been asked today to speak about someone dear to all of us, dear to you and to me, Mary, our mother. I love to speak about Mary. This month, the month of May, is Mary's month, and 13th of this month, we celebrate the feast of Our Lady of Fatima. My dear friends, I like to begin with a story, an ancient Russian legend about Andrew the Apostle, the patron saint of Russia. The legend says that Andrew the Apostle had a deep devotion to Mary while he was on earth. And after his martyrdom, when he went to heaven, he was keen on meeting her again. He searched for her everywhere in heaven, but he could not spy her. Finally, he turned to the angel who was guiding her and said, "Where is Mary?" To his surprise, the angel said to him, "She is not here." "Then where is she?" asked Andrew. And the angel replied, almost casually, "She is on earth, wiping the tears of her suffering children." She is on earth, wiping the tears of her suffering children. That, dear friends, is only a story. But it brings home a lovely truth. Mary, for us Catholics, is not a queen, a distant queen far up in heaven. She is a mother close to us, and we have experienced a maternal care, especially in moments of danger and difficulty. Just before he died, my dear friends, Jesus gave us four gifts, four precious gifts. He gave us first the gift of his peace. We all remember his words at the Last Supper, John chapter 14, verse 27. And we are reminded of this gift each time we come to Mass just before Holy Communion. "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled." Peace is one of the parting gifts of Jesus, and nothing, not even the ravages of COVID, can take away that peace from our hearts. A second gift that Jesus gives us is his own body and blood. Very early in his ministry, Jesus had made a promise of giving us his body and blood. The whole of John chapter 6 is about Jesus, the bread of life. And in that chapter, Jesus refers to the bread of life very often. "I am the bread of life. The bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh." John chapter 6, verse 51. When Jesus first made that promise, you know the reaction of his hearers. His hearers said, "This is a hard saying. Who can accept it?" And many of his hearers walked away from him. And then Jesus turned to Peter, "Will you also go away?" And Peter gave a magnificent answer, the act of faith that we make our own. "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life." At the Last Supper, my dear friends, Jesus fulfilled that promise. You all know that, and we celebrate that gift of Jesus each time we come for Mass. He took bread, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this and eat of it." He took the chalice of wine and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and drink of it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many." My dear friends, at that moment, when Jesus gave us the Eucharist, there was hatred all around him. At that moment, the chief priests and the Pharisees were plotting his death. Judas had already made up his mind to betray him. At that moment, Jesus gives us his best gift, his own body and blood. He leaves not just a relic, something to remind us about him. He gives us the gift of himself. Jesus gave us the gift of his peace. He gave us the gift of his body and blood. And he gives us a third gift, the gift of his spirit. Five times in the Last Supper discourses, Jesus speaks of the gift of the spirit. In John chapter 14, verse 16 to 17, 14:26, 15:26, 16:7, and 16:12. He offers us the gift of the Spirit of Truth, the Advocate, the Counselor, who will be with us always. The Spirit comes to the Apostles graphically at Pentecost, but it really is the gift of the dying Jesus. John's Gospel tells us that as he died, he gave up his spirit, John 19:30. My dear friends, Jesus gives us his peace. Jesus gives us his body and blood. Jesus gives us his spirit. And he gives us a fourth gift, the gift of his mother. I invite you, my dear friends, go back to that scene of Calvary. Jesus is there in agony, and from the cross he sees his beloved mother and his beloved disciple. His strength is ebbing away. Almost in whisper tones, he turns to first his mother and says to her, "Woman, behold your son." And then to the beloved disciple, "Behold your mother." My dear friends, reflect for a moment on those words of Jesus. Jesus addresses Mary not as mother, but as woman. The word woman takes us back to Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. Immediately after the fall, God makes the first promise of salvation. He says to the serpent, "I'll put enmities between you and the woman, between your offspring and hers. He will strike your head and you will strike his heel." Genesis 3:15. This is the first glimmer of hope for humanity. Immediately after the fall, even though the evil one has triumphed and will keep on striking at human beings, Genesis says that the offspring of the woman one day will crush the head of the serpent. Jesus is the offspring of the woman Mary, who accomplishes this on Calvary. The author of Genesis tells us that the first woman is given the name Eve, because she is the mother of all the living, Genesis 3:20. My dear friends, in addressing Mary as woman, John takes us not only to the first book of the Bible, Genesis, he takes us also to the last book of the Bible, the Apocalypse, the book of Revelation, chapter 12, which speaks of the woman clothed with a sun, with a crown of 12 stars on her head. She, along with the child, is attacked by the serpent, the dragon, but God protects her. And the scene ends with the words, "Then the dragon was angry with the woman and went off to make war on the rest of her children, those who keep the commandments of God and hold the testimony of Jesus." We are among Mary's children who are constantly facing the assaults of the evil one. My dear friends, there is so much in that word woman. But let us not stop there. Let us listen to Jesus. He says, "Woman, behold your son," and to the beloved disciple, "Behold your mother." Behold your son, behold your mother. Those words, my dear friends, call to mind any similar phrase in John's Gospel. When John the Baptist sees Jesus pass by, what does he do? Pointing to Jesus, he says, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." John 1:20 and John 1:35. When Pilate presents Jesus crowned with thorns to the people, what does he say? "Behold your King." John chapter 19, verse 14. It is the same phrase, "Behold." Scholars call this a revelatory formula, a formula that reveals a special role that the person will play in our salvation. The dying Jesus gives Mary the role of being a mother to his disciples. All those who, like the beloved disciple, remained faithful to him to the very bitter end. And he gives the faithful disciples the grace of being able to regard her as their mother. And the gospel incident ends with the words, "From that hour, the disciple took her into his own home." John chapter 19, verse 27. We, dear friends, have taken Mary into our home. A picture of her is there in our homes. But we do even more. We take her into our hearts. We turn to her, especially in moments of difficulties and trouble. Christians have experienced her closeness at such moments. To take one example, we celebrate October as the month of the Rosary. 7th October is the feast of Our Lady of the Rosary. What is the origin of that feast? It was a moment of mortal danger for Christians. When the Christian forces were about to engage in battle with vastly superior Turkish forces, what do? Then they turn to prayer. They turn to Mary and start praying the Rosary, and they won the battle. To commemorate this victory, Pope Pius V instituted the feast of Our Lady of the Rosary on the 7th October 1571. My dear friends, it is in this light that I would like to situate the apparitions of Our Lady, so many of them down history, beginning with the first alleged apparition in the year 40 to St. James the Apostle in Compostela, Spain. All these apparitions testify to the concern of Mary's heart. She bears in her bosom the suffering of humanity, the pain of each of her suffering children. Her heart cannot bear to see humanity suffer. Every now and again, she leaves heaven, so to speak, to be with the children. The present liturgical calendar commemorates three such apparitions: Our Lady of Lourdes, February 11th, Our Lady of Fatima, May 13th, and Our Lady of Guadalupe, December 12th. But these are only three of the many apparitions in different corners of the globe, including the apparition at Velankani in Tamil Nadu. I'd like to say a word, dear friends, about Fatima, since it is so popular among Catholics. This feast celebrates the appearances of Mary to three shepherd children: Lucia, who was then 9 years old, Francisco, 8, and Jacinta, only just 6 years old. To these three children, Mary, whom the children described as more brilliant than the sun, appeared 6 times, from 13th May 1917 to 13th October 1917. She urged them to recite the rosary, to pray daily, to obtain peace and the end of what she called the Great War. At that time, the First World War was raging. The last apparition at Fatima was on October 13, 1917, which was accompanied by a spectacular display often called the Miracle of the Sun or the Dance of the Sun, when people saw the sun spinning like a disc, rolling on itself as if seeming to fall from the sky. Fatima has become a great pilgrim center, attracting thousands of pilgrims each year. Pope Paul VI, Pope John Paul II, Pope Benedict XVI, and Pope Francis have all visited Fatima at different times as pilgrims. In fact, John Paul II visited Fatima 3 times. My dear friends, we could ask, from a theological point of view, what is the value of the appearances at Fatima? Even though successive popes, beginning with Pius XII, have accepted the supernatural origin of the Fatima events, our faith does not oblige us to believe in the apparitions. In October 1930, the Church declared that the apparitions at Fatima are worthy of belief, officially permitting belief in Our Lady of Fatima, but not compelling Catholics to believe in the apparitions. The apparitions all belong to the realm of what is called private revelations. The Catechism of the Catholic Church distinguishes between what is public revelation, meant for all, and private revelations. And we listen to what the Catechism says in number 67. It says, throughout the ages, there have been so-called private revelations, some of which have been recognized by the authority of the Church. They do not belong, however, to the deposit of faith. It is not their role to improve or complete Christ's definitive revelation, but to help live more fully by it in a certain period of history. That means that we pin our hope, our faith, not on private revelations, but on Christ's revelation given to us in the Gospels as understood by the Church. Fatima is one such private revelation. Given the fact that so many popes have spoken favorably of Fatima, and that the Church has instituted the feast of Our Lady of Fatima, it would be perhaps foolish not to accept Fatima. But one can choose to be a foolish Catholic. Even foolish Catholics have a place in heaven. My dear friends, people often focus on the secrets of Fatima, especially the so-called third secret. But the heart of Fatima does not lie in any secret message. Seeking to unravel secrets is a matter of futile curiosity. The Mary came not to reveal some secret message, but an open message, to caution the children and call them to pray and to repent from their sin, lest they suffer the consequences. The message of Our Lady of Fatima is nothing else but a reminder of the core message of Jesus in the gospel. The core message, to repent and turn back to God. Jesus began his ministry with those words, repent and believe in the good news. Our Lady of Fatima calls us to turn away from our sinfulness and selfishness, to observe the laws of God, to respect the earth given to us by God, and to value every human being on the face of the earth. My dear friends, is this not an apt message for us as we face the scourge of coronavirus? Unlike the Battle of Lepanto, we are today battling with a foe not visible to the human eye, a virus. To counter this foe, besides medical aid, besides observing the protocols laid down by the government and taking precautions, we as Catholics turn to prayer. We use the corona of the rosary. Corona means the crown of the rosary, to counter the coronavirus. The coronavirus is for us a challenge to live the gospel message. That message so well summed up by Pope Francis in his dream given in the encyclical letter of Fratelli Tutti. Namely, that as members of a single human family, as fellow travelers sharing the same flesh, as children of the same earth, we work to bring out the richness of each human being. The Pope calls us to dream of a family of nations, where everyone thinks not merely of the present, but also of future generations, all those who will be coming after us. During the first wave of coronavirus, Pope Francis composed two lovely prayers to be recited after the rosary. Many of us are familiar with that prayer. I like to end this talk with a few excerpts from the second prayer given to us by Pope Francis. I invite you to join with me as I recite the prayer that is being flashed on the screen. We fly to your protection, Holy Mother of God. In the present tragic situation, when the whole world is prey to suffering and anxiety, we fly to you, Mother of God, and our Mother, and seek refuge under your protection. Virgin Mary, turn your merciful eyes towards us amid this coronavirus pandemic. Comfort those who are distraught and mourn their loved ones who have died and at times are buried in a way that grieves them deeply. Be close to those who are concerned for their loved ones who are sick and who, in order to prevent the spread of the disease, cannot be close to them. Fill with hope those who are troubled by the uncertainty of the future and the consequences for the economy and employment. Mother of God and our Mother, pray for us to God, the Father of mercies, that this great suffering may end and that hope and peace may dawn anew. Plead with your Divine Son, as you did at Cana, so that the families of the sick and the victims may be comforted and their hearts be opened to confidence and trust. Protect those doctors, nurses, health workers and volunteers who are on the front line of the emergency and are risking their lives to save others. Support their heroic effort and grant them strength, generosity and continued health. Be close to those who assist the sick night and day, and to priests who in their pastoral concern and fidelity to the gospel are trying to help and support everyone. Blessed Virgin, illumine the minds of men and women engaged in scientific research, that they may find effective solutions to overcome this virus. Beloved Mother, help us to realize that we are all members of one great family, and to recognize the bond that unites us, so that in a spirit of fraternity and solidarity, we can help alleviate countless situations of poverty and need. Make us strong in faith, persevering in service, constant in prayer. Mary, consolation of the afflicted, embrace all your children in distress, and pray that God will stretch out his all-powerful hand and free us from this terrible pandemic, so that life can serenely resume its normal course. To you who shine on our journey as a sign of salvation and hope, do we entrust ourselves, O clement, O loving, O sweet Virgin Mary. Amen. God bless you all.